And today in the afternoon session, there are two lectures, so I'll be taking that. And what we'll see is count min and count sketches. Okay, so you know what is a sketch and what is a linear sketch. And this will be, both of them will be linear sketches. And we'll see like some applications of it. And for the first one, for the first sketch, count min sketch, we'll see, as an application, we'll see like a heavy hitters. So we have done heavy hitters at the very beginning, a two-pass streaming algorithm to find out all the heavy hitter items. Okay, and we will just recall it. Okay, and that's that comes as a application of count min sketch, and then later we will see like a count sketch. And two applications of it, like which is called sparse recovery and then L0 sampling. So one of them, like maybe both of them, will be tomorrow, and those applications we will use later for graph streaming. Okay, even though like here it is numerical problems, but later we will use it for graph streaming. So just quickly recall what you have seen regarding frequency estimation. So I guess you have seen, frequency, a frequency vector. Am I correct? And then the term frequency estimation. In today's lecture, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So the setting is like, we have a stream of tokens. Each token is a number between 1 and n, an integer between 1 and n. And so we know n in advance, so we can define fi to be the number of times I occur in the stream. And accordingly, we can define a frequency vector, which is f1, f2, etc. up to fn. So you could think that, the input stream is making some modification to the frequency vector. Frequency vector initially was zero. Initially it was zero. And whenever an item comes, like, say e1 is equal to 5, then you are going to increment the fifth location by 1 and keep doing like that. So you can think about like that. Okay. What is the most important questions associated with these frequency moments is like a frequency vector is frequency moment. Like what is the kth frequency moment? Fk is equal to summation I fi to the power of k. Okay, when you substitute k equal to zero, then that is same as, distinct elements. And when k equal to one, that is equal to the number of tokens in the stream M. And in the last talk, you might have seen F2 estimation, right? K equal to 2. And for this, you have seen an algorithm, which is Morris counter, which is log M. And of course, there is some term related to delta and epsilon, where delta is the, failure probability and epsilon is the, approximation factor. Similarly, here also there is a term related to epsilon and delta. And if that is constant, I can write order of, right? So in terms of n plus m, here it is order log n plus m, here it is log n plus n. And for the F2 estimation, it is, log n plus m. And all of these are like randomized, and they will be giving some kind of an estimate, or in other words, like they are epsilon closed. So now, okay. Okay, now, so just recall what we have seen in the, maybe my first talk, right? where I talked about mod majority and the heavy hitters problem. And what is the heavy hitters problem asking? Within an array, like array of m numbers, like the output all the numbers that occur at least m by k times. So the so that is same as saying that, okay, look at the frequency vector of that array numbers in as a stream and look at, you know, frequency of each element, so which is defined as fi, like for the element I or the number I, and then we want to output, say, like all the items such that its frequency is at least m by k. And we have seen an algorithm, a deterministic algorithm, Misra-Gries algorithm, which will output deterministically, it will output all the heavy hitters using a two-pass algorithm, right? And the algorithm was like this. So you have k counters and then k, and at any point in time, algorithm will be keeping some potential heavy hitters. And if the next item is an element in this potential heavy hitter, it will increment one of the counter associated with that potential heavy hitter to be one. And if that is not the case, then you are going to decrease all the counter by one. And if there is a counter free, then you are going to associate that counter with the new item you have seen. And you know, at the end, we will have like an array D and an array S, where S is potentially contain the heavy hitters. And at the end of the stream, what you do is you will verify. So here, you know, so A of 1, 2, 3 up to M, you can think it as E1, E2, etc. up to EM. And at the end of the stream, you will test whether all the elements stored in the S is a heavy hitter. If it is a heavy hitter, you will output it. Otherwise, you will not output it. Right, you will say that, okay, that is not a heavy hitter. And we proved that, you know, whatever the algorithm output, it is correct, and our algorithm will output all the heavy hitters. Do you remember this algorithm? Do I need to go a bit more?
No, sir, I think you did it. So we remember.
Okay, so this was an algorithm to, output heavy hitters. How, and this we can implement it in the streaming setting, like, you know, this is the first pass and this is the second pass. It's two pass streaming algorithm. And what we have proved, like, you can see that the space usage is order k, because we need to use this one and this one, okay, these two arrays. Because of that, it is order k words, or like order k log m bits. And then we proved that, you know, what we have, okay, so I need to define what is, yeah, so pi hat is equal to d of r, if, you know, I is equal to s of r, for some r, otherwise it is zero. And then we proved that, you know, this holds for all the values you stored in, you know, fi hat, it is at most the fi, and it is at least the fi minus m by k plus one. And any item with fi greater than m by k is in the RAD at the end of the algorithm. So in the second pass, you will detect them anyway. So this was the algorithm, say a two pass algorithm, and a two pass algorithm, using this much space, and that's it. Okay, and this algorithm has some drawback. One of the drawback is it cannot handle deletions. Okay, have you seen the seen turnstile model, or like, is this term used in any of the talks?
Yeah, we did.
Okay, so or in other words, it will not work in turnstile model. this is, and which model this is called, like this algorithm? Do you remember which model this algorithm? Only insertion only model. It's a cache register model, right? So it will work here, but it will not work. So if you are going to say like, okay, you have seen an item, you know, EI, now later you are going to say like, okay, delete one occurrence of item EI, okay, like, or like some number, okay, or in other words, like all the operation here you are talking about, go to the IT location, you just increment it by one or by some number, okay. Now or if okay, or like so in the tensorflow model you can also say that, okay, go to the IP location and decrement it by one, okay. So that is called the tensorflow model. Okay, I will explain it more formally in the coming slides, okay. So what I want to say is the algorithm you have seen, it will work only in the insertion model, like, or in the cache register model, and it will not work in the tensorflow model, okay. Now okay, now the count min sketch, which we will see in this lecture, we will use that to solve heavy hitters problem, okay. And that will be a randomized one. And why to go to randomized one? Again, so that it will allow deletions, so it will work in the turnstile model, okay. And it has additional applications, and that, okay, that's it. Now, so we look for a richer model where, like, you know, we allow deletions, or in other words, rather than just this frequency vector, think about the following scenario. Okay, frequency vector means that you have initially a vector which is all zero, and you know, when an item arrives, what does it say is, you go to the some of the location, jth location. So suppose EI, the ith token is equal to J. What does it mean? Go to the jth location in the frequency vector and increment it by one. Okay. Now, now to define about the turnstile model, what we can think about is like EJ can be, you know, a tuple. Sorry. Yeah. EJ can be a tuple ij comma delta j. What does it mean? In the frequency vector, you go to the ijth location. So here I will have like, you know, say I just use x here, okay, as a vector. Initially it is x1, x2, xn, this is equal to 0, okay. And when jth token ej comes, and how does token look like? Token is a pair, ij delta j. You go to the ijth location, and so this value here is xij. You replace this xij with, like, you just turn xij to be xij plus delta j, okay. And this value delta j can be positive or negative, okay. In the frequency moment question we have seen so far, or like I have explained, this delta j is equal to plus one all the time, okay. Now if you allow deletion in the frequency moment, it is either plus one or minus one. So we can think about it, it's a more general problem where I have a vector x which is initially zero, and each item in the stream ej is a pair ij comma delta j, where delta j could be positive or negative. And what does this token say? The token says the following: go to the ijth location, ijth entry in the vector, which is xij, and that xij you convert into xij plus delta j. So it may be you may be incrementing that value by delta j, or yeah, you will be incrementing that value by delta j, and this delta j could be a negative number as well. So in that case, it is actually the value will be less than xij. Okay. Is the model clear in the streaming setting what we are looking for? Okay. And we will ask, you know, at the end of the stream some question related to x. Okay, so maybe like we will ask, okay, so we can ask the following question: what is, you know, the zeroth norm of x? What is the one norm of x? You know, the L2 norm of x. These question we could ask. Okay. Okay. So you can think that, okay, what you have seen in the frequency moment, you where like that f vector is replaced with x, and instead of addition by one, you allow, you know, addition by some number, any number delta j. Okay, cool. Okay, so we will work in that richer model. Okay, so a vector, and it is getting updated when we see more and more tokens. And at the end, we need to ask a different question. Now, when delta j greater than zero, this is called cache register model, which means that there is no deletion, like it's all incrementing. And delta j equals to 1 is a special case. That is what we have seen in the case of frequency moments. Okay, and delta j is arbitrary. That is called turnstile model. Okay, so you think that minus some number is same as deletion. Now there is another term which is called strict turnstile model, where delta j is arbitrary, but all the time the x will be greater than or equal to zero. Or in other words, if at some point in time you have this quantity here and xi equal to zero, then there will not be an item which says that, okay, go to the ith location and decrement it by some number. Okay, such things are not there. All the time this x value stays non-negative, but in the intermediate steps you have, you know, delta j negative delta j, so that is possible. Then that is called a strict turnstile model. Okay, so what we will see for the count mean sketch, that will work in the strict turnstile model. Okay, and the count sketch which we will see later, that will work in the turnstile model. Okay, now to motivate how the count min sketch works, think about this heavy hitters problem. Okay, what we are asking, okay, there are n values, which is f1 f2 etc up to fn, right? There are n values, f1, f2, etc. up to fn. And these, the whole of this is revealed by the end of the stream. And at the end of the stream, I want to output fi, like all the i such that fi greater than m by k. So there are at most k such items or k such, you know, values. Okay, among f1, f2, etc. up to fn, there are at most k entries in these f1, f2, etc. up to fn. They satisfy the following thing, right? Fi greater than m by k. So just think about that heavy hitters problem. Okay. Now, suppose you do, you know, these indices, you know, the I values for which this is heavy hitter, like they be like b1 b2 bk. So let b1 b2 bk be the heavy hitters. What do I mean by that? fb1 greater than m by k. So suppose, you know, fb2 is also m by k, it's also greater than m by k. So these are the heavy hitters. Okay, now suppose you do, you know, you pick a hash function and you do hashing. Okay, and you do hashing like, so you have these these indices 1, 2, 3 up to n, you do hashing using a hash function h, where you expect all the heavy hitters go into different buckets. Okay, so now here you have more than, you know, CK bucket, like more than K bucket, say 1000K bucket. And then if all the heavy hitters are like, you know, spread across, or in other words, two heavy hitters won't go into one bucket, then what will happen? In each bucket, either you have no heavy item, or you have one heavy item and there are a lot of other small items. So this will contain, you know, one heavy item, and this will contain one heavy item. So every bucket will contain at most one heavy item. So you are going to extract, you know, heavy items from these buckets, and in each bucket you are going to have at most one heavy item. Is the intuition clear? Like, and we'll use, you know, hashing to do that. Is the intuition clear? Okay, good. Okay, so that is the kind of idea we use for count min sketch. Okay, there are more things to add to it. Okay, so but that is the central idea. Like heavy, you know, items spread across with pseudo hashing. Okay. Now here is the count min sketch algorithm. Okay, it's by Cormod and Muthukrishnan. And a count min sketch, it has two parameters, W and D. Okay. Now you will see what is W and D. Okay. So you will pick D pairwise independent hash functions, H1, H2, etc. up to HD. They are D pairwise independent hash functions. They map all the items. So how many items, like, how many indices are there in that, you know, our frequency moments? There are n, right? So it maps 1, 2, 3 up to n to W, like 2 W. And what is this? This is 1, 2, 3 up to W, and this is 1, 2, 3 up to n. So let me call these as items. And whenever I say, like, in the frequent, like in the streaming setting, EI, which is a token, okay, so that we have two different terms. Item means that, you know, EI is a token, and, you know, this EI could be equal to item J, and EI plus one is another token that could also be token J. So let me call this is item and this is token, so that I have two terms to refer. Okay. Now, say call it a token. Okay. Now, while the stream is not empty, look at the token. Like, look at the current token. Let that token be, you know, ET. Now we are in the strict turnstile model. Strict turnstile. What do I mean by strict turnstile model? This could be positive or negative. But all the time, this, like, the so initially we have x is equal to all zeros. And at some point, like every time, we will be keeping a vector, like this vector is getting updated, which is x1 to xn. So at any point in time, each of these xi is greater than or equal to zero. Sorry? Is there any question? Any question? Okay. So that is the setting. So we have x, which is completely zero initially, and we are going to get, you know, tokens. We are going to get stream of tokens, and each token is of the form, you know, it delta t. And what is it delta t says? It delta t says, okay, it delta t says that, okay, look at the entry xit, and that entry you change it to xit plus delta t. So that is what, you know, the problem supposed to do. Okay, and at the end of the stream we want to output, you know, x tilde, which is equal to x1 tilde, x2 tilde, etc. up to xn tilde, xn tilde. Okay, at the end of the stream I want to output, you know, a vector x tilde, where each of these xi tilde is very close to xi. Like, I will define what is the meaning of very close to xi. So that is our objective. So x is getting updated in a streaming session, and you know, some of the token says that, you know, in some location this value is decremented by some quantity delta, but I'm guaranteed that at any point in time the algorithm, each of the entries in this vector is greater than or equal to zero. That is guaranteed. And at the end of the stream I have to output, you know, a vector x tilde, where, you know, x tilde will have entries like the coordinates are like, you know, x1 tilde, x2 tilde, x3 tilde, like that, and each of these xi tilde should be very close to xi. Okay, now what do I mean by close? That I will define. Okay, now so what the count min sketch does, it's actually doing that. Okay, so it will output some x tilde such that every coordinate is some sense close to its corresponding coordinate in x. So how does it work? Okay, it will take let me rub this. Okay, it will take d pairwise independent hash functions, and then so let me draw a figure here. So it takes d pairwise independent hash functions. Let rho represent those. Okay, so h1, h2, h3, etc. up to hd. Okay, d independent hash functions. Okay, and what is the column represent? The column represent the buckets, the range of the hash function. That is 1, 2, 3, etc. up to w. Okay, now what is this HL of, like, look at this quantity, HL of, you know, J, HL of J, say this is J, and this is say HL. Okay, what is HL of J I want? Okay, in HL of J, I store at the end of the stream, what does HL of J contains? Okay, or like, you know, sorry, not HL of J, like I would say, like let this entry CL of J. Okay, let me call it HL of J is a bad notation. Okay, so here I will be storing something which is call it C of L comma J. Okay, what does CLJ should contain? CLJ should contain the following. Okay, look at all the items which are mapped to the jth bucket by the lth hash function. Okay, look at all the items. So or in other words, this is okay. Look at all the items which are mapped to the jth bucket by the lth hash function. Like those are the i's, like item I is mapped to such that, and then take the sum of those coordinates. Okay, summation xi, where I is such that HL of I is equal to J. Okay? So this is what I want to be getting stored here. Is the idea clear? So I will take D pairwise independent hash functions. Each of them will have like the range of that, the number of buckets that hash function will make is W. That is why here these two parameters, we will set W and D, in the coming slides. Okay. And like we will have, how many values? D times W values. Okay. And what is this CLJ value? CLJ value is this. Okay. I want the CLJ value to be this. Okay. Look at all the items which are mapped to the jth bucket by the lth hash function and take some of those xi's. Okay. And to do that, what I can do is like look at the tokens. It comes as a stream. Let et be the current stream. So initially what it will contain, initially all the xi's are zero. So initially this table contain, initially this table contain zero, fully zero. Okay. Now when an item comes, some of the entries here will get updated. In each, when a token comes, one entry per row will get updated. Okay. So when L going from 1 to D, what you do? You look into the bucket where IT is mapped. Okay. There you are going to add, like in that location, you are going to add a delta T. Okay. And that's it. Okay. That is how you compute this matrix. So the matrix has D rows and, W column. And this is the process of update. Okay. When a token comes, token has set up, like a token is a pair, right? IT delta T. So, and then for a token, you will make D update one per row. Okay. So in the lth row, how you make the update? You go to the bucket where IT is mapped to. Let that be, that is this bucket, right? Where IT is mapped to. Okay. There you add delta T. So delta T could be a positive or negative. But we are guaranteed that we are in the strict turnstile model. So some guarantee is there. Okay. And that is how we update, this matrix. Or in other words, like this W times D values, we, maintain like that. And at the end, I want to, what I want? I want this. I want X tilde. Okay. At the end, I want X tilde. And how do I make XI tilde? The, ith entry of X tilde is, look at where, okay, why it is not getting updated? Let me see, just a minute. My system got hacked. You cannot start screen share while other participant. Okay. Share screen. Okay. Yeah, sorry for the interruption. You know, how do I compute this x tilde? Like, look at the value xi tilde. Xi tilde will be the following value. Like, I look into all the d hash functions where these I the item I is mapped to, right? So the so the item I is say, it says that, you know, item I for the first is mapped here, and by the second it is mapped here, by the third it is mapped here, and it is here, like that. Okay, look at that particular level, like one per row. Among all such things, you pick the minimum. Among all such things, you pick the minimum. So xi tilde will be the value CL HL of I, where L is going from minimum over CL HL of I, where L is going from 1 to B. Or in other words, look at the first location it is mapped. Look at the location it is mapped by the first hash function, second hash function, third hash function, like that. And so you will have, like, you will be getting one value per row, right? So you will be getting, you know, L values. Among those L values, you will be getting D values. Okay, among those D values, you pick the minimum. Is the algorithm clear? Is the algorithm clear?
Yes, sir.
The input is like X is in a streaming fashion, and the output is, you know, X tilde, and which supposed to be close to X in some sense. Okay. And now, so the way we did, the way we updated this one, XL HL of IT, so we can say the following, right? CLJ is equal to this quantity. This is okay. This is what we want. This is what we did. Okay. Okay. So you can think that it is a counter CLJ. Simply count the sum of all xi such that HL of I is equal to J. All the items map to the jth location by the lth hash function and take their sum. Okay. So that is what it is. Okay. So just to remember that. Okay. And Now you think in terms of your heavy hitters. Okay, suppose there are k heavy hitters, b1, b2, etc. up to bk, and you know, consider bi. The hash function hl sends bi to hlbi. Okay, so cl of h of bi counts xbi and also other item that has to the same bucket. So think in terms of your heavy hitters. So look at the heavy item bi. You know, heavy item bi means xbi. So that occur at least m by k times. Then, you know, the bi is mapped to hl of bi, and look at the counter value c of l comma, you know, this should be hl, right? HL of BI. There, what all values we stored? We have stored XBI plus something else. So actually, in this location, what we have, this is at least XBI. Or in other words, if I look into that particular number, that is at least XBI. So if I'm going to say that, okay, that value is my estimate for XBI, which is XBI tilde, then that value is an overestimate. It will never be an underestimate, because that value is always higher than my actual value. Okay. Repeating with many hash functions and taking minimum is the right thing to, like, because we are always doing an overestimate. So among all the estimates, pick the minimum one is the best thing, because like if I have like, you know, for X BI, I got 1,000, 100, 200, 50, then I know that, you know, all these values are greater than X BI. So the naturally the best possible thing we should pick among all these values is minimum, right? And we never did an underestimate. It's all overestimate. So the minimum makes sense. And that's why we do here. So that is the intuition regarding why we took minimum. Now here is the, property of our output, or in other words, like the correctness. Okay. Suppose I pick, you know, D to be the number of hash function to be log 1 by delta. Okay. Think about it is a constant. Okay. And that depends on the error probability. Okay. And then for, when you fix any item I, then as I said, xi is always less than or equal to xi tilde, because we overcount for xi tilde. Xi tilde will contain summation where like xi is there and something else is also there. Okay. So this is always true. This is because we are doing overestimate. And what we are saying is the probability that xi tilde is too far from xi is small. What do I mean by too small? Epsilon times, you know, the L1 norm of x. What is the L1 norm of x? L1 norm of x is the summation of the absolute values of the entries in the vector x. In other words, the L1 norm of this is equal to, this is x1 plus x2 plus etc. and xn. Okay. So the probability that xi tilde is greater than xi plus epsilon times the L1 value, L1 norm of x, is at most delta. So think that, you know, this delta to be 0.01. Okay. So if you take, you know, D to be log 0.0, log 100, okay, then log 100, that many hash functions, then for any fixed I, the probability that my estimate for xi, which is xi tilde, which is greater than xi plus epsilon times this value, the L1 norm of x, is upper bounded by delta. Is the statement clear? This is what we will prove. So we know that, you know, our estimate xi tilde is always greater than xi, and we say that xi tilde is not too far from xi with a good probability. Is this statement clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, okay, so some of the comparison with Mishra-Gries algorithm. In the Mishra-Gries algorithm, you know, we will not be doing, you know, overestimate. Okay. It will be always less than or equal to. But here we are going to do overestimate. Okay. In the Mishra, like if you think about the Mishra-Gries algorithm, the counter value D will be at most, you know, what is the actual value. Okay, now you know, for the heavy hitters, actual actual items are not stored. Like we need to do, you know, we need to search for all the items. Like you look for all XI. So you look for all X, for all I, you check the XI tilde value, then you can figure it out whether it is a heavy hitter or not. And that is not the case with Mr. Agris. It's already explicitly stored. So at the end, you need to do some post-processing to do to talk about heavy hitters, you know, just keep it aside. And but works in strict term scale model, we will explain it why, and hence can handle deletion. And here, like, space usage is this many counters, because what, why, what is W here? 2 by epsilon. What is this here? Log 1 by delta. And how many counters we use? W times D, right? The matrix dimension, D is the number of rows, the number of columns is W. So the number of counters we use is W times D, and that is this much, and this is this many bits, assuming that the sum of deltas to be at most M here. You just assume that the delta is a constant. All the time you say like add by 3, add by 5 or something like that, okay? And there are M tokens. Okay, now we are going to analyze this. We are going to give a proof of this lemma. So I want to prove this lemma. So what I do is, what is XI tilde? XI tilde is actually min of some values, right? And what we will say is, like, first we will analyze how far, you know, this can be for a particular, or for a fixed L. I'm just going to fix L. And then look for, you know, CL of HLI, which actually means that by the lth hash function, where does the item I map to, look at that counter value. And that is some sense, the estimate of XI tilde, that is the estimate for XI by that hash function. And you are going to take a minimum among all the hash functions. So first we will look into how good that estimate, and then we will apply the min operation. Okay. So for that, what we do is, first you just fix L, which means that you are going to fix a hash function. Like, remember the picture here, H1, H2, etc. up to HD. So you fix a hash function at L. This is what you did. Okay. And look at the bucket HLI, which is this. See, in this location, I is mapped to, or in other words, this is, what is this? This is HL of I. So here, what all you will see, what is this value? This value will be XI plus something, right? I prime not equal to I. XI prime, where what, okay, what is the property? HL of I prime C equal to HL of I. This is what's stored in this location. Okay. And among all the else, you are going to take the minimum. So first focus on, you know, what is this counter stores? Is this counter stores good value? Let us analyze that. Okay. So fix L. HLI is the bucket that HL hashes I to. Okay. Now, for the simplicity, you know, this value, the counter value, which is CL of HL of I, let that be the number ZL. Notice that this is a random variable, right? This is a random variable. And so what is ZL? ZL is equal to xi plus summation I prime not equal to I xi prime, where HL of I prime is equal to HL of I. Okay. Now you take expectation. So expectation of xi, what is expectation of xi? Expectation of xi is xi, right? Xi is a, you know, scalar here. And then you will have like expectation of this summation, okay? And this will happen only when, you know, if the like, look at all the I prime not equal to I, if I prime is mapped to the same location as I, then you will be adding it. So the probability that HL of I prime is equal to HL of I times XI. So are you fine with this step? Do you agree with this step? Expected value of ZL.
Yeah, because I think we should all, yeah, fine. Yeah, because we should also consider those things which get mistakenly hashed to this. Yeah.
This correct. Place. Okay. And what is that, yeah, their probability and that.
Yeah.
These XI values are scalars. You need to think it's not variable. Okay. And when you add, when all the things are mapped to the same location, and we are taking the location where, you know, this location SL of I, so definitely I is mapped to that location. So I don't have to take there what is the probability of mapping there, because we are talking about that location only. So this is fine, right? So this is fine. This statement is fine. Now, what is the probability that HL of I prime is equal to HL of I? I just fix HL of I, then what is the probability that HL of I prime is equal to HL of I? It is a pairwise independent hash function. So how many buckets are there? 1, 2, 3 up to W. So it can go into one of these 1, 2, 3 up to W buckets. And we are asking what is the probability that, you know, the I prime goes to this bucket HL of I. That is 1 by W. Okay. So you will get here that probability to be 1 by W. And what is this quantity? This quantity is upper bounded by, what is W? This quantity is, okay. This quantity is upper bounded by, sorry. You just take a summation of the absolute values of all the XIs, you know, and then take, you know, 1 by W. What is W? W we said to be 2 by epsilon. That's why we get to this quantity. Clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, look at this. Expected value of ZL is at most X plus, you know, epsilon by 2 of the, you know, L1 norm of W. And what we want here, look at this statement. We want, what is the probability that xi tilde, like you think about, in place of xi tilde, you think about ZL. So we are asking, okay, what is the probability that ZL greater than xi plus epsilon times this norm, x1 norm. So which tail inequality you may apply here? See, what we are asking is this one, right? The expected value of ZL is at most this. And we asked the following, right? ZL, like X tilde you replace with ZL, is greater than XI plus epsilon times. What do you think? Which one you will apply here? Probably. So you have seen a lot of tail inequalities. So we eventually we want to talk about, you know, the min of ZL, right? So just to talk about the what is the probability that ZL has this. Like I don't want this number, but to get that number, what kind of inequality you will apply?
So simply we can apply Markov, but it will not give a good value.
Okay. You're correct.
Expected value to the left and apply Chebyshev.
That also we can do. Yeah.
But to apply Chebyshev, you need to do.
Yeah.
For the what you random need? Variable should be positive, independent.
Ah, okay. That's a good point. Where the random variable should be positive for?
Markov.
Okay. Here is the random variable positive.
Strictly turnstile.
Yeah, this is strictly turnstile. Yeah. Mm.
Okay. So, but okay. Now, if you want to apply Chebyshev, like, what all you need? What more you need? What more ingredient you need?
We need variance.
You need variance. So far we have not computed variance. So
yeah.
So just stick to the Markov inequality. Okay.
Now,
you look carefully, you will understand something. Okay. Now look at look at the following random variable, ZL minus XI. What is the expected value of ZL minus XI? XI is a scalar, which is at most epsilon times. Correct? Do you agree with this?
Yeah, I do.
Because XI is a scalar.
Mm.
That's all. Okay. Now, look at this random variable. Is this random variable positive or negative? I mean, can it be non-negative? Oh, sorry. Can it be negative? ZL minus XI. Can this be negative?
No, because XI, all the value, I mean, ZL is always XI plus whatever extra.
Yeah, okay. So this cannot be negative. So I can apply Markov on this random variable, ZL minus XI. That is the only place we use this is strict turnstile. Why this is like, because, you know, this quantity ZL C equal to XI plus some quantities. And all these quantities are positive. Because of that, ZL minus XI is always greater than or equal to zero. Okay. Or like non-negative, not positive, non-negative. Okay. Because of that, ZL minus XI is always greater than or equal to zero. And that is the only place we use. We are in the strict turnstile model. Okay. So what do? You apply Markov to this random variable. Okay, what you will get? What is the probability that, okay, I can write probability that ZL minus XI is greater than or equal to epsilon times X1. How much is this? This is expected value of ZL minus XI divided by this quantity, right? Epsilon times. And what is expected value of ZL minus XI? This quantity. And how much you will get? You do calculation, half. Agree? Is it fine?
Yeah.
Okay. Now I want to know what you apply. So I wonder what did we get? ZL, the probability that this is at most half. Now what we are actually taking, the min of these ZL values, right? See, xi tilde, if I write it, min of these ZL values, where L is equal to 1 to D. Where what is ZL? Where look at the location where it is mapped, like where I is mapped to, and look at that counter, and then that is ZL. So xi tilde is this value by our this new notation ZL. Clear? Now what I want is, what is the probability that xi tilde minus xi is greater than or equal to epsilon times, this is what I want. How much is this probability? See, you understood this? Xi tilde is min of ZL, like where L going from 1 to D, where if I talk about what is Z1, Z1 is the counter value C of 1 comma H1 of I. What is Z2? The counter value C of 2 comma H2 of I, like that. And what is Xi tilde? Xi tilde is min of these Z values, these Z1, Z2, etc. to ZL. And I want to talk about this probability. How do you get it? Okay, when does this happen? When does xi tilde minus xi greater than epsilon times x1? Like epsilon times the L1 norm of x. When does that happen? Like, no, forget about probability. Okay, like if that event happens, then what all things will happen? See, if this happens, then Z1 should be greater than this quantity. The Z1 minus Xi should be greater than this quantity. Z2 minus X should be greater than this quantity. Z3 minus X should be greater than this quantity.
Yeah,
Z4 minus Xi, all of them, right?
Yeah.
All of them should happen. So then what is this probability?
Maybe product of all those.
Yeah. And why you can write it product of all of them? Why you can write product of all of them?
Independence?
Because they are independent.
Yes.
I mean,
yeah. Correct. Each H1, H2, H3, they are independent. It doesn't depend. H2 doesn't depend on H1. And vice versa. Similarly, like any HI does not depend on any of the other, you know, HJs. They are like, you know, separate hash functions. Yeah. So what you will get is now what is the D you substituted? D is log 1 by delta. Correct? Log 1 by delta. So if you look at here, D is the number of hash functions. Like look at the statement here. You just take log 1 by delta, a constant times log 1 by delta. Now 1 by 2 to the power log 1 by delta, a constant times, then you can choose that constant to be in such a way that this is at most a delta. Agree?
Yeah.
So now, okay, what we got is like, okay, now if I take, you know, log 1 by delta hash functions and W, the width of the hash function, is 2 by epsilon, and then if I fix 1i, then what is the probability that xi tilde greater than xi plus epsilon times x1, like the L1 norm of x, is at most a delta. Now, if I want to talk this all together for all the i's, then I need to apply union bound. For that, what you do is, you just decrease this probability to be 1 by n square. Now, how to make it 1 by n square? You just take here more than 2 log n. If you take more than 2 log n hash functions, then what will happen? Like, you just substitute here, you know, delta to be how much it will be? Log n square. Log n square means delta to be 1 by n square. Then you will get this probability to be 1 by n square. Take d to be log n square. Okay. Then what you will get here? 1 by n square. Delta, now, like when you take log n square, the delta, 1 by delta is n square. So delta is 1 by n square. So the probability of failure for a particular I will be 1 by n square. Then what you do is you apply union bound. What you will say, like, okay, what is the probability that in one of them is bad? One of them is bad is like, you know, is upper bounded by, you know, x1 is bad or x2 is bad or x3, sorry, x1 tilde is bad or x2 tilde is bad. What do I mean by bad? X1 tilde is much more than this quantity, like x1 plus. So you take union bound there on the complement, like, then what you will get is like, with probability at most 1 by n, there exists I such that xi tilde is greater than xi plus there exists, okay, epsilon this one. Or in other words, what will happen when, like, what is the complement of that? It's like with union bound, you can say with probability 1 minus 1 by n, for all I, xi tilde is at most xi plus epsilon times the L1 norm of x. And so just to summarize, so that's what we get. Like, you substitute here d to be log n square, that is 2 log n. So the number of counters you use is d times w, d is 2 log n, and the w is 2 by epsilon. That many counters you use. In each counter, you will be storing a number. That number is at most log m, assuming that, you know, each of these delta values is a constant. So at any counter, you will have at most, you know, this many bits. Like, or like total number of bits will be bounded by this. So this is the, you know, space complexity in terms of bits, in terms of number of counters. Okay. So that's, I want to talk about, you know, count min. And after the break, we will see like how we can use this to, you know, just it's heavy hitters is just straightforward. You just need to apply count min sketch. That's all. Okay, so we will see like how we can use it, like just one slide, and then we will move on to count sketch. Okay, so let's come back at 4, just a 10 minutes break, and then we will do the rest. Okay, any question? Okay, then.